Good morning, students. Now in this class, we are going to talk about operators in C language. Okay. In previous class, we have studied about some fundamental concepts like what is a computer, what are the various characteristics of a computer, and what are the drawbacks of a computer, how a computer is look like, and what is a C language character set. At the same time, what is the history of C language, how we are going to invent the C language, who is the founder of C language, and next one is C tokens. In the C tokens, we have studied about keywords and variables, how we are going to declare a variable, and what about next one is variable, what is a variable. Next, what are the various constants? Okay, all those things we have covered in previous class. Now in this class, we are going to concentrate purely on operators. What are the different types of operators we have, and what are the different types of data? Data types also we are going to study in this class. Okay, first of all, what is a operator? See, generally an operator is a symbol that informs to the computer to perform a particular task. Here there is one more term is operand. Okay, the operand is nothing but the data item that operator act upon are called operand. See here, operator is nothing but it is one symbol. For example, plus is one operator, that is one symbol. Minus is one operator, that is one symbol. Okay, so in order to perform the arithmetical and logical operations, definitely we need operators. For example, I want to add two numbers, 5 plus 6. Here I need a plus operator, that is addition operator. Like that, here operator is nothing but symbol. So generally in C language, we have major categories are three types of operators are there. First one is unary operator, second one is binary operator, and next one is ternary operator. These three are the basic classifications. See, what is meant by unary operator? If the operator requires only one operand, then it is called as a unary operator. That means, for example, A plus, it is a unary operator. What is a binary operator? Binary operator is nothing but if it requires two operands, then it is called as binary operator. Okay. Then whereas, what about a ternary operator? See, the ternary operator is nothing but it requires three operands, then we can call it as a ternary operator. These three major classifications again are subdivided into various categories. That is arithmetic operator. That means C language supports a different set of operators. That is arithmetic operators, or relational operators, logical operators. And next one is increment and decrement operator. Next one is assignment operator, bitwise operator, conditional operator, special operators. All these are the various categories of C language operators. Among these operators, arithmetic operator, relational operator, logical operator, and assignment operator. These four are called as binary operators. Okay, what is meant by binary? It requires two operands. Whereas next one is only one operator, that is unary, is increment and decrement. Here, increment and decrement operator, we can call it as a unary operator. And next one is conditional operator is a ternary operator. Okay. See here, what is meant by ternary? We require three operands. Okay. See, we are going to see one by one operator, how it works. Okay. Then first one is arithmetic operator. See, what is meant by arithmetic operator? See, if you see the arithmetic operators, you are going to learn easily. That is, first one is plus. Plus is nothing but addition, minus, into, divided by, and a division. Okay, that is here division and mod. So all these are the arithmetic operators. Okay, see, what is meant by arithmetic operators? Arithmetic operators are used to perform arithmetic calculations. All these are the operators by using which we are going to perform the arithmetic operations. Arithmetic operation means addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and mod. Okay. See here, operator is plus. That is, we can say it is an addition. For example, 10 plus 5, it is 15. Like no, subtraction, 10 minus 5, it is 5. Like no, multiplication, 10 into 5, it is 50. Next one is division. Division is a arithmetic operator. 10 by 5 is 2. Okay. Whereas if you take division, it is 10 by 5. Okay. Again, here values 2. Okay. Here it is the mod. Okay. A remainder of the division we are going to take. Mod means, okay. That is, for example, 5 mod 2 equal to 1. All these are the 5 different arithmetic operators. Okay. That is plus, minus, into, next division. Next we can call it as modulo division. Okay. Among these 5 operators, we have highest priority. Priority is nothing but for which we are going to calculate first. Okay. Highest priority operator is into, then division, then modulo division, then plus, then minus. Okay, this is the priority from highest to lowest. Okay, so this is the arithmetic operator. So next, coming to relational operators. The relational operators are the less than, greater than, less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, is equal to, not equal to. So what is the relational operator? See here, relational operator is nothing but the operator which are used to perform comparison between two values. Okay, so if we are going to take two values, in order to compare those two values, of course the result of those two values may be a true or false. In order to perform the comparison operation of two values, then only we are going to use the relation operators. These operators returns true. The comparison is true, otherwise it returns false. Okay, if it is, whenever we are comparing the two values, if it is true, then it returns true value, otherwise it returns false. Okay, here the relational operator are used to check the relationship between two values. Every relational operator has two results, either it may be true or false. Here first one is less than. Here it returns true if the first value is smaller than second value, otherwise it returns false. See here, one example is there. 10 less than 5, is it true or false? Okay, 10 less than 5 is a false. Okay, then a greater than. Greater than is nothing but, here also same thing, it returns true if the first value is larger than the second value, otherwise it returns false. Okay, for example, 10 greater than 5, is it true na? Okay, it is the greater than operator. And at the same time, less than or equal to, less than, greater than or equal to. Here less than or equal to also same thing. It will return true if the first value is smaller than or equal to, okay, second value. Otherwise it returns false. For example, 10 less than or equal to 5. It is a definitely false. Okay, like no, greater than or equal to. For example, here example is 10 greater than or equal to 5. It is true. Okay. Next one is equal to. It always is equal to means it returns true if both values are equal, otherwise it returns false. For example, 10 is here equal to means 2 equal to. 10 is equal to 5. It is not true. Okay, so its value is false. For example, 10 equal to 10, then result is true. Okay, like no. Next one is, next relational operator is not equal to. It returns true if both values are not equal, otherwise it returns false. Okay, same thing. 10 not equal to 5. Is it true? Yeah, true only. For example, if you take false also, okay, 5 not equal to 5, okay, like this, okay. So all these are the various relational operators, okay. What is the purpose of relational operator is, whenever we are going to performing the comparison operation, then we are going to make use of relational operators. So next one is logical operators. See, we have totally 3 types of logical operators are there. Okay, here what is the purpose of logical operators? In order to take a decision based on 2 or more conditions, then only we are going to use the logical operators. First one is logical. There are 3 types of logical operators are available in C. That is logical AND. First one is logical AND. Next one is logical OR, and next one is logical NOT. You can say logical not. Okay. What is meant by logical AND? Logical AND result in true if both the conditions are true, otherwise it returns false. Okay. If here first one is logical AND, it returns true if all the conditions are true, otherwise it returns false. Okay. Oh, why? Because here if you see the one example, 10 less than or equal to 5, is it true or false? 10 less than, false. Otherwise 12 greater than, here it is true. Okay. here false and true, and it will return false. Why? Because a logical AND will return true if all the conditions are true. Okay, here I am taking two conditions. If two conditions are true, then only the value is true. Okay, here one is false, na? So the result is also false. Like that, logical OR also. Okay, logical OR results in true if either of the condition is true. Okay, among the two conditions, any one of the condition is true, then the result is true. Okay, here 10 less than 5, logical OR. 12 greater than 10. Why? Because here second condition is true, na? So the result is also true. Okay, next one is logical NOT. This operator negates the result of the condition. It means if the condition is true, it gives false, and if the condition is false, it gives true. Okay, so here logical AND, logical OR. Okay, and at the same time logical NOT. All these three are the logical operators. Okay, then next one is increment and decrement operator. See, what is meant by increment and decrement operator? See, these operators we can call it as a unary operator because both needs only one operand. Okay, the representation of the increment and decrement operator is here operator is plus plus. Okay, for example a plus plus, a minus minus. Okay, here a is one operand. Okay, that means we are going to implementing the increment or decrement operators, we are going to use only one operand. Okay, the increment operator add one to the existing value of the operand, and the decrement operator subtract. Here increments addition of increment is nothing but addition of one, whereas decrement means a subtraction of one from the existing value. Here operators are plus plus, minus minus. Plus plus means increment, that is add one to the existing value. Decrements means subtract one from the existing value. Here for example int a equal to 5, a plus plus means we are going to add one to the 5, that is a value is 5, na? A plus plus means 5 plus 1, that is a equal to 6. Like, no, decrement operator also int a equal to 5, a minus minus means we are going to subtract one from the a value, that is 5 minus 1, that is equal to 4. Okay, here increment and decrement operators, we have pre increment and post increment at the same time, pre-decrement and post-decrement. Okay, whereas pre-increment is nothing but first we are going to increase the value, then only we are going to evaluate the expression. Whereas post-increment is nothing but if you take the post-increment, if the plus plus operator followed by the operand, then we can call it as a post-increment. In this method, old value of the operand is used in the expression, then it is incremented. Okay, first value is evaluated, then only will increase the value. Okay, so all these are the different types of increment and different decrement operators. Different types means only two, that is plus plus and minus minus. Okay, next, coming to next operator is assignment operator. Okay, the one and only assignment operator in C language is equal to, single equal to. Okay, but why we shown here plus equal to, minus equal to, into equal to? All these are the compound assignment operators. The only one assignment operator is equal to only. So what about remaining? Remaining operators are compound assignment. Okay, see, what is meant by compound assignment? See, compound assignment is nothing but if we are using more than one operator, okay, then we can call it as a compound. Compound means more than one, that is two operators. Here plus equal to is a two operators, minus equal to is a two operators. If you are using more than one operator, then we can call it as a compound assignment. Okay, we generally have two types of assignment operators, that is simple assignment operator and compound assignment operator. Simple assignment operator equal to, simple assignment operator is nothing but only single equal to, whereas compound assignment operator equal to, compound assignment operator is nothing but plus equal to, minus equal to, star equal to, by equal to, division equal to, modulo equal to. Okay, here the assignment operator is used in different variants along with the arithmetic operators. Okay, here I am going to use the assignment operator with plus, minus, into, division, modulo division. Here the thing is, for example, simple, here for operator is simple assignment, first one, equal to. What it means? Assigning the right hand side value to the left hand side. For example, a equal to 10. What it means? I am going to assign the value 10, which is at right side, to the value a like this. Okay, a equal to 15 here means I am going to assign the value 15 to the a. Okay, next one is plus equal to. What is meant by plus equal to here? For example, a plus equal to 10 means it is nothing but a equal to a plus 10. A equal to a plus 10. E plus equal to is nothing but add both left and right hand side values and store the result into the left hand side variable. Here example is, for example, a plus equal to, here plus equal to is the compound assignment. Okay, a plus equal to 10 means it is nothing but a equal to a plus 10. Like no, a minus equal to b, it is nothing but a equal to a minus b. Same thing, a into equal to. Okay, it means I am going to use the compound assignment operator. A into equal to b is nothing but a equal to a star b. Like no, a division, a by equal to is nothing but a equal to a by b. Like no, here we are going to use the compound assignment operators. Okay, here the thing is assignment operator is only one, that is simple assignment. Okay, that is equal to only simple equal to only. Okay, remaining all are the compound assignment operators. Okay, whereas if you take the topic of assignment operators, we are going to know the simple assignment along with compound assignment. Okay, then next topic is bitwise operators. See, what is meant by bitwise operator? Okay, so here bitwise operator is nothing but we are going to operate on bits. Okay, so bitwise operators are used to perform bit level operations in the C program. Okay, generally we are going to implement these operators in bits only. Okay, you know how we are going to convert the one value into binary. For example, here a is one value 25 and b is one value that is 20. Okay, so the value of 25 in binary is 11001. Okay, like no, 20, for 20 the value of binary is 10100. Okay, so these are the bitwise operators. Here what are the various bitwise operators is bitwise and, bitwise or, first one is bitwise and, bitwise or, bitwise, third one is bitwise XOR, next one is bitwise complement, we can say bitwise complement, and next one is right shift, next one is left shift. Okay, here just like as a logical operators, but we are in the logical operators we are going to take the conditions. Okay, here we are going to operate on the bits. Okay, for example, here I am going to take a and b two values, a equal to 25, b equal to 20. Here, whereas in bitwise and or bitwise or bitwise XOR, we are going to performing on the bits. Okay, for example, if you take bitwise and, the result of bitwise and is 1 if all the bits are 1, otherwise 0. Okay, here what will happen is whenever I am going to performing the bitwise operator for A25, B20, okay, first of all A25 means 11001, then under this one I am going to write the B value, that is binary only, 10100. Okay, see here, whenever we are performing the bitwise operator, bitwise AND operator, the result is bitwise AND is 1. Okay, if all the bits, if 2 bits are 1, okay, then only the result is 1, otherwise 0. Okay, like no, bitwise OR. Okay, bitwise OR, the result is bitwise OR is 0 if all the bits are 0, otherwise 1. Okay, A by B. Like no, bitwise XOR also. What is the bitwise XOR? The result of bitwise XOR is 0 if all the bits are same, otherwise it is 1. Like no, we are going to performing the bitwise operators on bits. Okay, so simply we can say bitwise AND, bitwise OR, and bitwise NOT. Okay, we can say it is a truth table. Okay, whenever if you take the bitwise AND, if it is 00 values 0, 10 values 1, like no, like that, if you take bitwise OR na, the value, if it is 00, then value is 1, 11 value is 1. Okay, like that. Okay, we are going to perform the bitwise operators. So next one is conditional operator. See, what is meant by conditional operator? See here, the conditional operator, we can call it as a ternary operator. Okay, Why? Because here we are going to use the three operands. Okay. It is used to check a condition. What is the conditional operator? Question mark, colon. Okay. Conditional operator is question mark, colon. Here we are going to use the three operands. It is used to check a condition and select a value depending upon the value of the condition. It is also known as ternary operator because it operates on three operands. Okay. Here, if you see the syntax of conditional operator, first one is condition. We are writing the condition, then question mark. Then we can say true pot. True pot means statement one. We can say statement one colon next to false pot. That is, we can say statement two. If the condition operator, how we are going to execute this conditional operator? If the conditional operator first evaluate the given condition. First, it will check the given condition. If the condition is true, then statement one means true pot is executed. If the condition is false, then statement two means false pot is executed. Okay. Here I am writing a equal to 10 less than 15. Again, conditional operator, that is question mark. 100 colon 200. Okay, first I am going to check the condition. 10 less than or equal to 15. Condition is true. Okay, condition is true, na? So which statement is going to be executed? True statement. That is, what is the true? We have 100. So what is the a value? A equal to 100. Okay. So this is the conditional operator. Next we have special operators like a size of, a pointer, comma, dot. All these are the special operators which are used in C languages in various purposes. For example, size operator is in order to find out the size of a particular data type. Okay. For example, size of variable. Here, size of int. Variable name is, for example, if I will give int, then I am going to find out the integer size or float. I am going to get the size of a float value. Okay. We are going to get the, by using the size of operator, we are going to get the size of a particular variable. Okay. Next one is star. Star, we can say it is a pointer operator. The pointer operator is used to define a pointer variable in C language. Whenever we are working with pointers, we are going to use the operator called star. Next one is comma operator. Generally, a comma is one operator which is used to separate the two variables. See, whenever we are working with variables, we know the declaration of a variable. For example, if you want to declare two variables in a comma b, here comma is the one operator. Why? Because we are using comma here in order to differentiate the two variables, that is a, b. In between a, b, I am going to use the comma. Comma is one operator, dot operator. Mainly the dot operator is used to access the members of a structures. Okay. In order to access the different members of a structures, we are going to use the dot operator. Okay. All these are the various types of operators. Okay. Next one is data types in C. Okay. Generally, we have different types of data. Okay. Whereas we have integer data. Again, we have float data. Okay, by using this data type, what is a data type? What is the definition of data type? By using this data type, which type of data we are going to store into a variable? The data type is a general name assigned to any data sharing a common set of characteristics. By using this data type, it specifies the type of data that can be stored in a variable. That means what type of data we are going to store into a variable. Generally, the data types or general classification of data types are three only. Okay, first one is primary data type or fundamental data type or basic data types. Next one is a derived data type. Next one is user defined data types. Okay, whereas the primary data types or fundamental data types are integer, float, character, double, and void. Okay. And second category is derived data types. Okay, derived data types are, we can say, arrays, functions, structures, unions, and pointers. Whereas user defined data types. Okay, user defined data types is nothing but type def and enum. Okay, here enumerated types is there. Those are nothing but user defined data types. Okay, don't confuse here. Total classifications are four. Okay. Here void is nothing but void is a primary data type. Okay, the major classifications are three only. Fundamental data type, derived data type, user-defined data type. Fundamental is nothing but primary only. Okay. In this primary data type, we have integer, float, character, double, and void also. This void is also comes under primary. And the second category is derived. Okay. See, four here. Derived is there now. In this derived, we have arrays, functions, structures, unions, pointers. Whereas next one, next category is user-defined data types. User-defined data types of type def, enum. Okay. Next, first of all, we will see what is a primary data type. Okay. See here, primary data types in C language are the basic data types. All these are the data types which are already defined in the system. Okay. Here, integer, floating, character. In integer, we have signed int and unsigned int. Like no, assigned int for integer, I'm going to represent as int. Okay, signed int, signed short int. Okay, next one is long int. Okay, whereas in the category of signed, unsigned, we have int, short int, long int. How we are going to read unsigned int here? It is unsigned short int, unsigned long int. Like no, floating also floating point. Floating is nothing but decimals. Okay, integer is nothing but without decimals. Floating is nothing but decimals. Here characters is nothing but whenever we are going to represent the character, then we are going to use the character data type. Here float, double, long double, all these are the family of floating type. Whereas character type, we have character, signed character and unsigned character. Okay, this is the basic category classification of primary data types. Okay, so next one is here primary. In this primary, we have int, that is a signed short int, a short int, next long int, next unsigned int, next unsigned long int. These are the family of integer, na? So in this one, what along with sizes, along with specifiers, okay? Here mentioned, what is the size of the integer, that is 2 bytes, okay? Short int is 2 bytes, again long int is 4 bytes, unsigned int is 2 bytes, unsigned long int is 4 bytes, okay? So this is the range, okay? Range of the integer, that is -32,768 to +32,768, okay? All these are the ranges of different integer type family. Next here, last column, we have format specifier. See, what is a format specifier? What is the purpose of format specifier? Whenever we are declaring a data type, in order to work with the data type, we need a format specifier. Without format specifier, a data cannot be executed by the computer. Okay. For example, if I am using the data type int, okay, if I want to execute the data type, definitely I need a format specifier. Okay. Here, without format specifier, any data type cannot be executed. Okay. For that one, we are going to take format specifiers. Okay. See, the each and every data type will have its own format specifier. Whenever we are using the particular data type in the program, definitely along in order to execute that data, we are going to use the format specifiers. Okay. You should remember the format specifiers also. Integer format specifier is %d. Again, for short int, a %d. Long int, same %d. Unsigned int %u, unsigned long int %u. Okay, in this table you should remember type along with size along with format specifiers. Okay, it is integer family. So next one is floating family. Generally, float data types are a set of numbers with decimal values. Okay, in order to represent the decimal values, we are going to use the data type called as float. In the float family, we have float, double, long double. So size of float is 4. Double is 8, long double is 10. Same, if I am representing, I am using the float data type, definitely we need format specifier. Okay, the format specifier is %f, for double %ld, for long double also %ld. Okay, then next one is character type. We have character type family in order to represent the character data. Okay, here character and unsigned char, that is we can say single char, signed char. Okay, for character the size is 1. For unsigned char, the size is 1. The format specifier is %c. Okay. See, the entire data types in brief. Okay. Integer, floating, double, and character. What is integer? Integer is nothing but number without decimal value. Floating means number with a decimal value. Number with same decimal. Why? Because double is a family of floating now. So character means any symbol. Okay. What is a keyword? For integer, we are going to, in order to represent the integer data, I'm going to use the keyword called int. Whereas a floating point, I'm going to represent the floating point data, I'm going to use the keyword called float. For double, I'm going to use double. Character, I'm going to use the character. If you see the keywords, totally we have 32 keywords are there now. Among those 32, we have these keywords are there. Int, float, double, char. These four are the keywords which are comes in the 32 keywords. What is the size of the keyword? It is in 2 or 4 bytes, depending upon the compiler. You should remember the sizes also. What is the size of integer? 2 or 4 bytes. Okay, again, float is 4 bytes. Double is 8 or 10 bytes. Character is 1 byte. Okay, this is the range. Again, format specifier. Format specifier for int is percentage d. Again, our percentage u. Here, float is percentage f. Double is percentage ld. Whereas character is percentage c. Okay, among these data types, you should know the what type of data will store how much, and along with a format specifiers. Okay, you should remember the memory size along with format specifier. For example, integer occupies how many bytes? 2 or 4 bytes. What is the format specifier of integer? Percentage d. Next, what about floating point? For floating, what is the size of float? 4 bytes. Percentage format specifier is percentf. Next, what about double? The size is 8 or 10 bytes. Format specifier is percentage ld. What about character? Character occupies how many bytes? 1 byte. What is the format specifier? Percent c. Okay, all these are the data types. Okay, along with data types, we have user defined. Void is one data type. Next one is derived data types. Okay, all these are the derived the data types which comes under derived is nothing but array, soup, and then structures, functions, unions, and pointers. Whereas enumerated means we can say user defined data types. Okay, enumerated type is a user defined data type. We are going to use the keyword called enum. Enum is the keyword which is used to represent the enumerated data types. Next, what about void data type? Here, void is a basically primary data type. The void type means nothing or no value. Generally, why we are going to use the void? Void is used to specify a function which does not return any value. Okay, so here void means no value. Okay, whereas in this derived we have already said now arrays, structures, union, pointers, all those things. Okay, so this is the concept of pointers. So next, coming to expression. See, what is a expression? In any programming language, if we want to perform any calculation or any frame, any condition, etc., we use set of symbols to perform a task. Okay, these symbols make a expression. Simply, an expression is a combination of operators and operands. An expression is a collection of operators and operands. Okay, operator is a symbol. Operand is nothing but for which we are going to apply the operator. That we can call it as a operand. Okay. Generally, in C language, the expressions are three types. That is, infix expression, postfix expression. Next one is prefix expression. Okay. See, what about infix? Okay. Here, what is the syntax of the infix? Infix means the operator is in between operands. Here, operand one, operand two. In between, we have a operator. It is infix. Okay. The operator, the expression in which the operator is used between the operands is called infix. Okay, here plus is the operator. Operator one, operand one is A, operand two is B. Okay, it is the infix. It means operator is in between two operands. Whereas the postfix means the operator is after operands. Okay, operand one is A, operand two is B. The operator, operand is after the operands. Okay, prefix means before the operand. We are going to use the operator plus AB. So it is the prefix expression. Okay, all these are the types of expressions in C language. Okay, then coming to one sample C program. Okay, display a hello world. Generally, each and every C program starts with main function. Whenever we are writing the program, every C language program starts with main function. Before main, we are going to use some header files. Okay, hash include stdio dot, hash include conio.h. What is the purpose of these two header files? Okay, so whenever we are writing the program, we are going to use some predefined functions. That is, main is one function, print is one function, so getch is one function. All those functions or our scanf is one function. All these are the, we can say, predefined functions. Okay, whenever we are working with programs, definitely we are going to write the printf or scanf or getch, like, no, all these functions are predefined functions which are available in the library called stdio.h. okay, so in order, whenever we are using these predefined functions, before that we are going to include the corresponding library, that is stdio.h. here hash include stdio.h means we are going to include this library stdio.h in our program. Like, no, next, what about hash include conio.h? Okay, in the program we are going to use one predefined function called clrscr. okay, clrscr is nothing but to clear the screen. Okay, so that clrscr function, that should be available in conio.h function. Okay, where if I am writing the program, okay, if I am using this conio.h clrscr, definitely I am going to use the conio.h function. Okay, so these, whenever we are writing any C language program, it is a good practice to write the header files. Okay, whenever we are writing on C program, okay, of course the C language program should start with main function. Before the main, it is very good practice to write the header files. Okay, here hash include stdio.h and hash include conio.h. like, no, every C program should starts with main function. Here we have main, opening braces, closing braces, and for main function we have open and close. Again, left parenthesis, we have right parenthesis. Simply, I am going to print hello world. Okay, in order to print, we are going to use the predefined function called printf. Okay, what is the purpose of printf? Printf is nothing but whatever we are writing in the printf statement, that should be displayed on the monitor. Okay, here simply I am writing printf hello world. Okay, see here what I am writing in the printf statement hello world. So whenever I compile this program, I execute this program, what is the output I'm going to get is hello world. Okay, this is the sample program to display hello world. Okay, after writing the C program, how we are going to execute the C program? Generally, if you take any program, in order to run the particular program, we need one editor. Okay, each and every language need one editor to, in order to execute or in order to compile the program. In C language also, we have one editor called TurboC. Where we are going to write our programs are in TurboC software only. Okay, it should be in blue screen. Okay, if once we installed the TurboC software in our system, in this TurboC only we are going to write the program. After opening the TurboC, it should be like this. It is just like as a blue screen. Here we have menu, file, edit, search, run, compile, like this. After opening this one, where we are going to type the program? Here first you should go to the file. In this file we have one option called new. Whenever you are pressing the new button, you should have one fresh window of TurboC. In that window you are going to type your program. Okay, after typing your program, you should save your program. Okay, after writing your program, second one is save the program. Where you are going to save the program? After writing, you should press F2. Okay, whenever you are pressing F2, okay, you should be like this. Okay, there is one path is there now. Okay, for example, C turbo C3 bin. Okay, for this one, after bin, you are going to give your file name. Okay, whenever you are giving the file name to the C language, you should end with .c. Okay, for example, you have written on program addition of two numbers. You should you are giving the file name like add. Okay, after add, the file name is add. Each and every C language program should end with .c. Okay, the file name should be add.c. okay, or abc or file name na, for example abc.c, or for example Razu. For example, your file name is razu.c. you should give the file name like this. Okay, after saving, okay, next we should compile the program and then run the program. For compilation, we are going to use the command called Alt+F9, or simply in the menu bar we have compile button. Okay, whenever you go to compile button and press the compile, or simply by using the Alt+F9, we are going to get the compilation process. and then after compilation we are going to run the program. Okay, to run the program again we have a menu bar. There is an option called run, or simply we are going to press Control F9. Okay, then finally in order to get the output we are going to use the command called Alt+F5. Okay, whenever you press the after run, whenever you are pressing the Alt+F5, we are going to get the output hello world. Okay, this is the execution process of C language. Then it is the simple program to print an integer. Okay, same. Each and every C language program should start with main function. Before the main function, I am going to use one header file, that is stdio.h. Why? Because I am going to stdio.h is one library. In this library, we are so many predefined functions. Whenever I am writing the C program, definitely I am going to write some predefined function in C program. In order to use the C program predefined functions, definitely I am going to use the corresponding library. Here I am going to include the stdio.h library by using the hash. Okay, hash is a preprocessor directive. We can call preprocessor directive hash include stdio.h. Here main, opening, closing bracket. Okay, main is the one method. Next left parenthesis, right parenthesis. All these statements should be written in main function only. Int number, here int is the data type, number is the variable. Okay, I am going to take one variable, name of the variable is number. Here I am asking printf enter the integer. Okay, so what is the purpose of printf? Whatever you are writing in the printf, that should be shown on the monitor. Okay, you are going to enter one value. Okay, you are going to give the value from keyboard. Okay, so what is the purpose of scanf? Okay, syntax of scanf is scanf double quotes, I'm writing the format specifier, and at the same time ampersand corresponding variable name. Okay, here what is the purpose of scanf? Scanf is a predefined function which are available in stdio.h only. Okay, by using the scanf I am going to read the particular number. Okay, syntax of scanf is scanf within double quotes, I am writing the format specifier. Okay, here why we are using for %d? %d is a format specifier of an integer. Here number is what type? Integer type. Okay, for the integer format specifier is %d, ampersand number. Next this is scanf for reading. Again finally I am going to print the value. Okay, for printf %d comma number. In order to print, generally printf we are using for two purposes. When whatever writing in the printf statement, that should be available, that should be shown on our computer. And the second one is printf is used for to print the value of C language program. Okay, see here two printf statements are there. Okay, here first printf enter an integer means it will on your after compilation, after running of your program on your monitor, we are going to get one message called enter an integer. Then what about last printf statement? It is the printf statement in order to print the value. So here the syntax is double quotes format specifier comma just variable name. Okay, here name of variable is integer. Okay, so for example after writing this program, whenever I compile and run this program, this program will ask us is okay, enter a integer. For example, if I am giving value 10, okay, then what is the output? Okay, the 10 value will be printed on our monitor. Okay, so like no, here also addition of two numbers program. Okay, here main, again left of flower bracket, right flower bracket, opening and closing flower brackets. Here I am going to take three variables. Okay, x, y, z. My program is addition of two numbers. Why? Here I am going to take the integer variables only. For that one I am going to take int. Okay, x, y, z. Okay, I am going to add two variables. But why I have taken z variable? Z is one variable. Okay, you know, addition of these two variables will be stored in another variable called z. Okay, so for that one only I am going to take z variable. Okay, here I am going to give the values from the keyboard only. Here printf enter two values to add. Okay, again after writing the printf we have scanf. Okay, so what is the syntax for scanf? Okay, double quotes, we are writing the format specifiers. Okay, here are two values I am going to add now. Double quotes, percentage D, percentage D. Why we are using percentage D? Here X or Y are the two values which I am going to add. X is of integer type, Y is of integer type. So definitely I am going to use the format specifier as percentage D, comma, ampersand X, comma, ampersand Y. Okay. First percentage D is for ampersand X and the second percentage is for ampersand Y. Okay. Again, next statement is Z equal to X plus Y. What it means? I am going to add the value of X and Y that should be stored in the value of Z. Okay. Here in C language, whenever we are using one variable, definitely before using that variable, we should be declared. Okay. So here I am using the variable Z now. So for that one only, in first statement, I am going to declare the variable, that is Z. Okay. So Z equal to here X plus Y. Okay. What is, for example, X value is 10, Y value is 10. What is the value of Z? X plus Y, that is 10 plus 10, 20. What is the Z value? 20. Okay. That Z only I am going to print finally. Print F, sum of numbers, percentage D, comma, Z. Okay. Here, what is the Z value? 10 plus 10. What is the Z? 20. Okay. So finally, this printf statement will print the value of X plus Y. Okay. See, if you see the output, enter two numbers to add. See why? Because whatever I am writing in the printf statement, that should be shown on our monitor. Okay. I am giving two values, 4 or 5. Okay. X value is 4, Y value is 5. Then 4 plus 5. What is the Z value? 9. So what? How? For that Z, what we are going to do, the Z value, we are going to print the Z value finally. Here, sum of enter number equal to 9. Okay. So this is the addition of two numbers program in C language. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.